Sri Tiruchi Siva, 7 minutes. Two speakers are there, so you, please see.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Chairman, sir. Sir, I today, as a member of parliament, is to perform my duty, which is to protect the basic tenets of the constitution, my constitution. I'm very firm, sir, my constitution, because the understanding of the government's constitution is entirely different from mine. Sir, whoever believes in pluralism, in an egalitarian society and a democratic India, where religion is not a barrier, to condemn some individuals as perpetually as second-class citizens. Sir, I, as a member of the DMK party, which is working on the same basic principles, I strongly oppose this bill. Sir, this bill seeks to provide citizenship to some illegal migrants from three countries, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Afghanistan. Sir, what is citizenship? Citizenship is a legal right to a particular country, for a person belonging to a particular country. In other words, citizenship bestows upon individuals membership to a national political community. In short, sir, national citizenship means an essential and enduring feature of modern life in terms of politics and elections, welfare and benefits, and all-round integration. Now, sir, there are four questions I would like to pose to the government to make us clear, because as everyone has pointed out, it is unconstitutional. And when it is being scrutinized by the Supreme Court, naturally everyone knows it won't stand to the scrutiny of the Supreme Court. Sir, it is against Article 14 of our Constitution, which ensures every citizen equality before law. No one should be discriminated. And so also preamble, very clear it is secular. This secularism is against secularism. Sir, what are my pointed four questions? Number one, why only these three countries have been selected? What is the rationale behind it? Sir, in the objects and reasons, it is said that millions of citizens from undivided India belonging to various faiths were staying in the said areas of Pakistan and Bangladesh when India was partitioned in 1947. Where comes Afghanistan here, sir? It was not in the undivided part of India. It was not an undivided part of India. So Afghanistan comes in. You may call it, as the Home Minister in his introductory speech said, the neighboring countries. Yeah. Taking that into consideration, I would like to ask why you have spared other neighboring countries? When Afghanistan has been included, why not Bhutan? Why not Myanmar? Why not Sri Lanka? All these countries have to be included. Why you have selected some three countries which are majority in Muslim population and you say that minority have been persecuted from these three countries? Sir, and again it has been justified that these countries have a state religion. Yes, our founding fathers were clearly said that India doesn't have a state religion because the doors are open to everyone, yep, irrespective of caste, creed or religion. But these three countries have, of course, Sri Lanka has a state religion, Buddhism. And Bhutan, it is having a state religion. And sir, for kind information I say, the Christians pray in their houses in Bhutan, and if they want to pray in churches, they are coming to India. Are you going to discard them? You are not going to include them? So also the Rohingyas from Myanmar, they are also persecuted. A section of the Muslims in Pakistan, the Shias, and so also the Ahmadis in Bangladesh, and the Hajras in Afghanistan, will they not be considered as human beings? So these are the very pointed questions we would like to. Why you cherry-picked these three countries, and why you have only on the basis of religious reasons and exclude only one religion?
Polarized.
Sir, it is actually polarized. And we feel very strongly whatever your attempts are in the recent days are pointing towards one particular religion in this country. Sir, a sense of apprehension has cropped into millions of the Muslims in our country. Sir, where will they go? They have also been persecuted. I would like to ask, if they have not been included in this naturalization process, Will they go back to Pakistan or Bangladesh or Afghanistan and plead that we have been persecuted in India and we are coming here? Or will they be put in detention cells? Very simple question, sir. Sir, why all these things? Sir, in Sri Lanka, from Sri Lanka, more than 1 lakh of people have come here since 1948. Because the Citizenship Act, when it was enacted, people were forced to come out. They were not able to enroll themselves as citizens. And after the 1983, the Black July, people came in large numbers. And very precisely, I say that for more than 30 years, they are living here. They are not able to practice. They study medicine, anything they do, but they are not entitled to be a legal citizen in this country. Sir, when we say, when you are coming forward to naturalize some of the citizens, the 1955 Citizenship Act completely provides for whoever should not be a citizen of this country. Later, sir, the 1920, 1946, leave alone all these things. 2015 and 2016, notifications of the government gave some exceptions, and that came as a bill, and now it is being discussed. So I am afraid, if this is passed, by way of your majority you are having now, sir, that will be a blow to our secularism. Sir, kindly think about those Muslims when India and Pakistan were partitioned. When Muhammad Ali Jinnah extended an invitation that all Muslims should come to Pakistan, some Muslims assured, yes, we are Muslims, but India is our nation, and they stayed here. Should we not honor their patriotism? So also, so many persecuted now have come here. The Muslims, a section of the Muslims are still being persecuted. The Christians are persecuted in Bhutan, and the Tamils in Sri Lanka are persecuted and are in Tamil Nadu. What are you going to do for that? We need justification, that's all. When you come forward to naturalize and give citizenship to some of those people who have been persecuted in some reason, in some countries based on religious, let it not be confined to religious only, on ethnic, on linguistic reasons, if they are banished or persecuted, they should also be considered. Sir, I humbly convey to the Honorable Home Minister, sir, he in the Lok Sabha said, we have got a mandate. Yes, you have a mandate. But that mandate is to justify all the citizens of this country.
Thank you.
Not to, sir, segregate one person and feel them agonized, pained, anguished, and victimized.
Thank you.
Sir, kindly, sir, I would like to again say, high time, I would like to quote Arinjar Anna, carry on, but remember, you have to hold the reins of your speeding horse, or else it would upset the apple cart. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So you have taken entire time of your party.